Hi, and welcome to Newsmakers for inside analysis and behind-the-scenes commentary from Santa Barbara's top journalists about the most important news events in our community. I'm Jerry Roberts. Tonight, we look behind these headlines. Santa Barbara's media landscape gets a jolt as the longtime owners of the Montecito Journal sell to a group of local investors. The Cave Fire reveals some improvements in evacuation communications, but significant problems remain. The SBPD unveils a new policy aimed at curbing crime by restricting sales of single-serve alcoholic beverages. And in our Remix segment, the panel recalls the biggest stories of 2019 and offers some predictions for the new year. Our panel tonight, Gwyn Lurie, Editor-in-Chief of the Montecito Journal. Delaney Smith, staff reporter for the Santa Barbara Independent. And Josh Molina, who covers politics and policy for NewsHawk. Thank you all for being here. So for those of you who got drunk on Halloween and missed the news, the Montecito Journal has been sold, and we are lucky to welcome Gwyn Lurie tonight joining us. Why in the world would you buy a newspaper at a time like this?
Because I think there's never been a time when local news is more important. And I think by virtue of the people who have backed me in this venture, it's clear that a big chunk of our community agrees. And I worked very hard to put together a group of, a well-rounded group of people from sort of across the political spectrum, because I think people are a little sick of the national media morass that we find ourselves in.
And kudos for publishing the names of the investors, which I thought was a good transparency to start off. Well, of course, you know, the Montecito Journal has been known as the outpost of the right wing for many, many years under the ownership of the Buckley family. And are you going to change the politics?
Well, you know, weirdly, a lot of the writers for the Journal are not necessarily right wing. I think Jim Buckley, who's kind of a well-known libertarian, was very transparent about his views and vocal about his views, and actually had a policy too of commenting on other people's editorials, which I think was a little hard to swallow for the half of us in the community who...
Well, it discourages people, I think, from participating.
Yeah.
So are you going to stop that? Are you going to end that policy?
That's done. That's done.
That's already done?
It's done. We're not taking any anonymous editorials. We're not... I'm not going to be commenting on other people's editorials. I will be writing my own and clear about my own views, and I think people can speak for themselves.
So you say in your initial column that your aspiration was to build community through inspired content and re-envision local journalism amidst the national media morass. What is that? How does that manifest?
It just sounded good.
Well, there's that. Yeah, okay.
How does
that manifest? In other words, what does that look like?
Well, I wake up every morning a little sick to my stomach about what's going on in our country right now. And I think a lot of that is about so many people sort of committing to a single story of others. And we have this community, it really is a 50-50 community. We have about 50 Republicans, 50 registered Democrats, and a lot of people from all over the country, and some people who have lived in Montecito, many families who have lived there for generations, families who stretch to be there, families who live more privileged lives. And I think there are so many interesting stories to tell, and I would like to start telling more individual stories so that people can have a three-dimensional view of who our neighbors are, because I think that's a fundamental piece of democracy.
I thought you were raising your
Is
hand.
Is that funny?
No, I thought he had
he
a
was
question.
Looking at me, I'm like,
it's okay. So what, you don't have a website. Journal doesn't have
No,
a website.
So the plan here is that we're building a digital, so a formal name of the company is the Montecito Journal Media Group. We are going to have a 360 flow of content from the newspaper to our digital site that we're building, and we're going to launch in March. And we're going to have a series of events and try to bring to life a lot of the content.
And I can reveal here exclusively tonight that you're going to have a
a debate between Laura Capps and Das Williams. When's that going to be?
We are. January 16th. We've rented Hahn Hall, and we're going to have a community, widely attended community forum for Das Williams and Laura Capps, and KCRW, I believe, is going to be there with us too.
Make a note of that. January 16th. We got to get him in here before then. Okay. The other question is, how do you define community? Is it just Montecito, or are you going to try to broaden?
So the
that
idea
out?
Is that the Montecito Journal is for people near and far who love Montecito and believe in the idea of community. Underneath the Montecito Journal newly designed name will be, community is more than a place, it's a way of being, that we're part of our community, but we're also part of the Santa Barbara community, and we're part of the world community. And so this is a way of, you know, of coming together over shared values and talking and having civil discourse over things we care about.
And as you know, the local media landscape has been fractured for some years, and there's not really one dominant news source. It's really a lot of niche sources. Do you see the Montecito Journal as being in competition with the Independent and NewsHawk and, God forbid, the widely popular Newsmakers with JR blog? Or do you see opportunities for collaboration? What does that look like?
I see a lot of opportunities for collaboration. And I don't think anyone could survive these days by working as a silo. I think partnerships are great things. I have a lot of respect for the people who run the Independent and write for the Independent, and same with NewsHawk. And now I'm going to hopefully have an opportunity to have conversations with everybody and figure out where there can be partnerships. This all sounds so Pollyannish, but I really do believe we're better together. And I will tell you one thing, though, about the Independent, which was a little bit part of my thinking about this, because I love the Independent. I mean, read it, and it really has been the paper in Montecito that I've read, and since I've lived in Montecito, that I read the most. I was part of the original group that started the Partnership for Resilient Communities, mm-hmm. who came together after the debris flow to raise a lot of money from our community to put some resilience up on the mountain so that we wouldn't have to live in fear. And the first newspaper who reported it was the Independent. And the opening line of the story was, Montecito has a new billionaires club. Mm-hmm. And I read that and I thought,
major blood boil.
No, I just thought, I was really glad to know I was a billionaire. it was not only was it completely incorrect given the people who started it, but it also just showed me how we put people in categories and it helps us understand who they are, but really it undercuts our ability to connect and to solve problems together and to talk about things in a meaningful way.
Josh does that a lot. He's really the worst offender.
I only do that with fringe alternative blogs.
Oh, stop. That fringe.
That
you wouldn't. You would. You wouldn't. Half your stories you wouldn't have if you weren't chasing me. All right. Last question. People want to know what's the because you know they have been so sort of provocatively right wing. I suppose what's going to be the role of the Buckleys? Are they in the partnership group or out of the partnership?
So
group?
We have paid Jim Buckley in full for the paper. He is an investor. Back in, he put a little bit of money back in. I managed to convince these amazing investors that I'm worthy of their trust. So the investors are part of an advisory board. They're not a voting board. So really the investors don't have any editorial say in what's in the paper.
Okay.
And so Jim would like to do a little bit of travel writing for us, which I'm completely happy to have him do. And Tim is just a different human being because he's Jim's son, but he's his own person. He's going to be the COO, which I'm grateful for because he knows a lot more about putting a paper out day in and day out.
And the purchase price was $2.3 million, or that's what you raised?
No, the purchase price was $1.35.
Okay. So you got $1 million to play with.
Yeah.
Beside absolutely. All this lucrative real estate
something
advertising
like that
you have. All right. Well, thank you for coming. I hope you'll come back and join the panel.
I think
it's really exciting that we have new ownership. The Montecito Journal has known its community really well, and the people have really bonded with it and enjoyed it. And you know, Montecito is, as we saw with the Thomas Fire and the debris flow, like everything runs through Montecito. We're all connected. So we all go to Montecito. We know people in Montecito. It's not like they're over there. So what I'm saying, Jerry.
Is he trying out for a job here?
I'm not really sure what's happening.
I know he's doing a really good job.
what are you doing for lunch
now? Well, the thing
and
is,
your point is,
the thing is, Jerry, we're all better when we have higher quality journalism. It makes us all more competitive, and I'm excited to see what's going to happen.
Oh, well said. Nice sentence. Okay, so we got the new normal now. We had a wildfire that just blew up, and then, of course, it was put out by the snow. So, you know, given the climate change and the fact that this is going to be kind of an ongoing problem, worse than historically it's been. What you've been doing some reporting about how the communications worked in the Cave Fire. What did you find?
Yes, Jerry. So to bring it back to Montecito really quick, during the debris flow on January 9th, a lot of questions in the aftermath were kind of raised of what if people knew sooner, because a big issue was that the maps that they were sending out to the public, the evacuation maps, had discrepancies. The text underneath did not match the map itself and vice versa. And as a result, Tyler Hayden at The Independent reported it last year. As a result, a handful, I can't remember off the top of my head, I think it was seven of those who died in the debris flow, they were not in the evacuation zone according to the maps, because everything was incorrect and all the notifications were coming out at the wrong time. So I went back and after the Cave Fire and said, like, what have we learned and what's different now as far as emergency notifications? One big thing that happened is that the Office of Emergency Management hired a full-time 40-hour-a-week a GIR specialist, which that is someone.
GIR?
Yes. It stands for geographic
Grr.
Something. Yeah.
Yeah.
But basically their expertise is making these maps. And there's someone who's specialized in OEM. All they do is make maps during emergencies that the public can read and that are accurate. So that doesn't happen again. So that's one of the really good things that's happened. Unfortunately,
but there were a lot of screw-ups.
Yeah, there were a lot of screw-ups. I put a word out to the public in general to come back to me with their experiences, and a few people who lived right there in that first area that was evacuated by the 154, they all seemed to get all their notifications on time.
That's great.
Yeah, and they all did. And then some of the second and third places either didn't get it at all or they got it hours later. And I talked to a couple women who said they literally packed up their bags, went door to door to their neighbors because there weren't any sheriffs going door to door. There was no notification system happening and telling them, come on, we have to get out. And they got out.
So who were the alerts? The alerts were coming from County Office Emergency
OEM.
From the fire department, or that was just on Twitter?
Well, this is the way that it works. So when it first happens, it's actually the people who are answering 911 calls dispatch. They are the first people who ever put out an emergency notification. And then after that, all of the county departments, depending on how big the emergency is, get together and decide what's the next steps here. So it starts with dispatch, and then it goes over to OEM in consultation with the fire department, city and county and police and all that. What they do, though, is they have these the people of the public don't realize that it's not like you just send a text and hit send. There's a really it's simple but complicated at the same time system where you type in these messages. Some of them are WIA, which means that's a federal thing, and it goes through the cell towers or the Ready, Set, Go. They aware and prepare alerts we sign up for don't go through the cell towers at all. They go through something called Nixle. So going through these different things, certain characters, certain little things really matter.
Why did it go out in Spanish when it wasn't supposed to, or vice versa?
It's supposed to, and now it's mandated. Doesn't matter if you speak.
No, English. But I mean, some people got only Spanish.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And I'm about yeah. And so it's mandated now that you have to send bilingual alerts no matter what. But because these things only allow X amount of characters, you have to send them separately, right? And they did it with a Spanish one, and the tilde symbol over the ñ froze the whole system up, and they had to call tech support. I mean, it froze it up for hours, so that's why there was such a long delay, and then when it finally went out, there's all these people who only got Spanish. So there's clearly still a lot of problems in the system. If this was a situation like the debrief of 1-9, yeah. I mean, people could have died. So.
And when is your story going to appear?
It's going to appear this week in The Independent with a couple more details that I didn't mention on camera. So stay tuned
for
that.
I want to
save some of the juicy parts.
Yeah. Marianne won't mind. She won't mind at all.
Jerry, these were the two. I gave you some good stuff.
Jerry, you want all the scoops.
Yeah. Well.
Who's going to read my story in a week?
I'll read it. I'll read it, Delaney.
Oh, thank you.
And will you?
I will totally read it. As long as you don't call us billionaires.
That wasn't your story.
No, I think, was it Nick? Sure that sounds like Nick. A Nick lead.
Oh, really? Kelsey, well, yeah. Kelsey, nice going.
Well.
She's gone now, right? She's in D.C.?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, she's gone. But still tweeting. Okay, Josh, so you covered one of the more singular public hearings I've seen at City Hall last night. Anthony Wagner, the public information officer for the cops, had a community hearing about some subject that we didn't even know was on the agenda. What was that all about?
He held a workshop to talk about ways to stop nuisance behavior outside of liquor stores and mini markets. It's part of larger plan by the city to reduce bad behavior targeted at the homeless people who have made downtown very difficult for a lot of the businesses, tourists, people to visit there. City Attorney Ariel Colon has taken more of a proactive approach to stopping some of these behaviors, and they've tried to have grocery stores pick up their shopping carts. They've tried to enforce public homeless people from having their public belongings on streets, and now they're trying to stop people from loitering in front of liquor stores and mini markets, buying single serve, single beer cans, airplane bottle.
Can they do that?
Isn't refrigerated beer, even.
Oh yeah. Well, isn't that all under the alcoholic beverage control?
The ABC grants licenses, so they can't go in there and say you don't have a license to do this anymore. So what the city of Santa Barbara and the police department, and what they floated at this meeting was this idea of an ordinance that basically says we're going to take a fee from you based off of the amount of alcohol you sell, and then we're going to have enforcement and cops hang out.
But only from the retailers, only from the supermarkets.
Yeah, from the people who sell.
So this
alcohol
doesn't affect bars at all.
This affects restaurants. This affects mini markets. It affects liquor stores. It does affect bars.
Oh, okay.
It affects anybody. But the real thing they're trying to get at, they're not really concerned about a downtown establishment like Institution Ale. You know, you don't have homeless people who buy a beer and then drink it on the sidewalk. These are off-sale alcohol sales, and so they buy the little
like 99 airport banana things.
Whatever, yeah.
You seem very familiar with those.
I just thought he didn't have a word, so it's gonna
airplane-sized alcohol liquor bottles, okay? And then they drink out front, and then they toss them. I mean, if you go walk anywhere near these places, you see a lot of trash and debris. And so Santa Barbara's trying to put a halt to
this. And according to Wagner, there's a lot of police calls around this as well.
Yeah,
yes?
He presented data that said that it takes up about 15% of total calls for service, calls to liquor stores and mini markets.
Wow, 15%.
Yeah, is for that. So he is saying this is costing taxpayers money, and we need to do something about it. There are some problem spots. Anthony was not specific to name different establishments, but everybody knows sort of problem spots around town where they attract loiterers. So they can't stop them from doing what they're doing, but they can say, enforcement officer comes and looks, and if we see a loiterer, if we see trash, if we see graffiti and you haven't cleaned it up, then we're going to fine you, or we're going to issue a citation, and that's supposed to be a way for them to be motivated. He looked at Oakland, which has a similar ordinance. There were several liquor store and market owners in the crowd, and I tried to talk to all of them afterward. And they were very upset with the presentation because they said that Anthony Wagner didn't show all of the sales tax revenue that their sales bring into Santa Barbara. They said it was a one-sided perspective, but they don't want to talk on the record because they don't want to be targeted, or they don't understand government. They fear as though something will happen where their businesses
will
be singled out.
Well, it is rather peculiar, and the broader issue, because we had the shopping carts, and then we had the possessions on the street that you have to put. I mean, all of this stuff is not being generated by council. It's not coming out of an ordinance committee. It's all coming from the city attorney's office.
Yes.
What? How is that? Why is that suddenly happening?
Well, Santa Barbara is trying to revive downtown. And now that we have these district election representation, we do have more of an attention on these outside areas. And Ariel Colon is a different kind of city attorney. He comes from Ventura. He has some experience in this, and he's trying to help Santa Barbara create an image where it's not a place where people come and see lots of homeless. Like, people who have lived here a long time know, just like everybody wants to live here, homeless people want to live here too. But he's definitely taken an enforcement proactive perspective on doing that.
Which the politicians aren't necessarily backing him up on, because Kathy and Kristen, for example, had that little kind of mini hearing.
And, you know, the homeless don't have a constituency, you know, so when they go to vote, they're not really thinking that way. But Kristen Sneddon, I think, just as a fundamental human
issue.
Well, they
have Nick.
What's that?
I said, well, Nick represents their interests pretty
well. Well, I mean, homelessness is a huge issue. It's a huge problem, not just for merchants and for people shopping downstairs, but it's a problem for the homeless. And so I think, and it's the same with, you know, children in the county. You know, it's interesting because I worked on a countywide task force called the Santa Barbara County Child Safety Net Task Force, where we did 87 hearings with all the stakeholders for the foster youth in the county. And when we presented our report to the supervisors, nobody showed up. And I thought, if it were stray cats that we were talking about,
yeah,
the room would have been packed. And these constituencies, they don't have lobbies, they don't have people fighting for them, and frankly, the press probably isn't paying enough attention to these issues either, because someone needs to light a fire under these, you know, they need somewhere to go.
No, I agree with that. My point is that it seems to me that the direction of most of the policy in recent years has been on supporting homeless people, finding services, finding shelter, finding things. And this is a departure from that, these last three initiatives that we've heard about.
It's city council and government is made up of people and personalities. And Ariel Colon, we saw it with vacation rentals. It's something where he went after and he said, we're going to change this. He's doing the same thing. It's part of a legacy. It's part of something that he wants to do. He wants to make a difference. Ortega Park, so many of these community parks have this problem, and they have mini markets and liquor stores nearby. So I think it's just a matter of, there are some people who want to address this issue and feel that it's not good for this to be happening in Santa Barbara.
All right. Well, that'll be something to watch in the next year. All right, we got about 3 minutes left. Really quickly, what was the biggest story of 2019?
The Conception fire, and I mean, it was a terrible tragedy. Well, just everyone talked about it, and a huge impact, huge loss of life, and it's going to have an impact on how
changing
regulations in the future.
Yeah. Unfortunately, that was also mine.
Okay. What was the second biggest?
I know, now I'm trying to
think about it. What was the biggest story in Montecito this year, do you think? The rings going in?
Well, for sure the nets going in. I mean, that was huge. It was kind of a miracle that that got done, and the community coming together and raising that kind of money. And
well, there's a lot of billionaires there, I hear.
There are a lot of billionaires. But you know what? We raised it in small batches. Locally homegrown small batches. but anyway, just that we got through, you know, that we got through the emergency permitting process, and these things move slowly, they're really hard to do. So that was a big
cannabis, right?
Cannabis, yeah. Let's go with cannabis. I was actually gonna go with, it's not really the biggest story of the year at all, but I was thinking just about housing and how
that's kind of the inclusion.
I mean the inclusionary housing ordinance, and we're moving the AUD in a new direction. There's going to be housing built on State Street. That's kind of a big deal.
Right. The correct answer is the defeat of Jason Dominguez by 8 votes by Alejandro Gutierrez, because it changes the whole complexion.
Well, I predicted it.
Well, you did.
Let's like remember that, because everyone...
All right, prediction for 2020.
I'm really looking forward to the outcome of the Laura Capps Doss Williams race. I'm not going to predict it, but no one would have thought that Doss Williams would be in this situation, because you usually get elected and you get sort of a cakewalk. You know, we had that huge LA Times story. Cannabis is the second biggest story of the year, because it's just sort of changed the whole viewpoint of Santa Barbara. It's the American Riviera. Some people say it's the cannabis capital, you know, of certainly California, the world. And so it's a big deal whoever wins that. I mean, if Laura Capps can somehow have the perfect storm and pull off the upset, that's going to be a huge story.
It'll be fun to cover. It's going to be fun to cover. What's your prediction for 2020?
Actually, the result of the conception investigation, I'm thinking, is going to probably be huge. I think there's something in there that no one knows quite yet.
And
as far as who's at fault and what really happened.
Now, is this another one of those things you're keeping from us until your story comes out?
We know it's 18 months after it happened, they'd have a report. So it's going to come out in 2020.
What's your prediction for 2020?
I'll tell you what I think are going to be big issues in 2020. For Montecito, I think figuring out the insurance question, because people have had their insurance dropped all over the place, and it's gone up tenfold in some cases for the
people
who've been able to help.
Although the insurance commissioner this year, didn't he put a one-year moratorium on those cancellations?
Not for my family, and not for a lot of families I know. I mean, it's a big problem.
That is a big problem.
It's a big problem. The other thing is, I think we're going to be looking at the oil rigs off the coast, what's going to happen to those rigs out there. And I think that the national election
is
very interesting.
Oh, I
maybe
thought it was local.
Even more interesting than the Doss Capps election.
Well, all politics is local, and I mean, yes. We want to know what's going to happen with Trump, but Doss Williams, Laura Capps, that's the story of a lifetime right there.
All right. Well, my prediction is that Megan Harmon will be the next mayor.
Megan Harmon. Megan Harvard graduates, stick together.
Next mayor of Santa Barbara when Kathy Murillo wins a squeaker against Jonathan Abood and Jason Dominguez.
Eric Friedman.
To be elected. Okay. Well,
you think Eric Friedman is going to be the next mayor of Santa Barbara?
I just want to disagree with him.
My other prediction is that the editor of the Montecito Journal will do something about these awful inside jumps on every page, so you have to go to page 52 to read Richard Meinhardt's.
Pick up the new Montecito Journal in March of 2020.
And this, Josh, for you, that the Los Angeles Dodgers will not win the World Series. Okay.
It still will not make your life better, Jerry.
Thanks to Gwyn Lurie, Delaney Smith, and Josh Molina. This is our last show of 2019. So first of all, now that Donald Trump has saved Christmas, Merry Christmas and Happy Holidays to all of you. Thank you for supporting Newsmakers throughout the year. We'll be back in January. In the meantime, please sign up for a free email subscription to our website, newsmakerswithjr.com, where you'll find my blog posts on politics and media in Santa Barbara and beyond. And should your insomnia be troublesome, check out our YouTube channel, where you'll find an archive of past shows and special interviews. Thanks again to our director, J.P. Montalvo, and to our crew tonight, Andrew, Elliot, Lee, and Ryan. And as always, our senior, top-ranking, high-powered, high-energy executive producer, Hap Freund. Thanks, and we'll see you next year on Newsmakers.